brighter than normal. Can you make sure? Can't save my contacts. Good morning, online family. We are blessed that you have joined us this morning. We are still flowing in all God did last Sunday for Resurrection Sunday, but we'll talk about that a little bit more after worship. This morning, I want to talk to you about Jacob's ladder. Jacob didn't have the same kind of relationship that his father did. He had not encountered the Lord yet. He didn't know him personally, intimately, just things that he had heard about the Lord. Maybe that's you this morning. Jacob had made some poor decisions. He was running. He was isolating. Maybe that's you this morning. Can I tell you, the Lord wants to meet you right where you are. What he did for Jacob on that special day, he wants to do for you this morning. So Jacob was running. He was tired. He laid his head on a stone, and he began to dream and have visions of angels ascending and descending, and God's promises raining down on him, and his love raining down on him, and Jacob was in awe. You see, the Lord wanted to remove the lies from Jacob. He wanted to remove the lineage of lies in his family. And the Lord wants to do that for you this morning too. So Jacob made a vow. He made a vow that to make the Lord of his life, and to walk in truth all the days of his life. And you can make that vow this morning as well. We have an altar call at the end of service, and that altar call is for you as well. You can make him Lord of your life this morning too. And let us know if you do, because we want to rejoice with you, because April 7th, will be the best day of your life. Amen?
Amen. Good job. That was awesome. So welcome, online family. Look, remember to send any prayer requests to onlinecampus@willowchurch.com.
Yes.
And one of our deacons will be up here shortly. But also remember, since we're online and you're away on business or you're at home, just remember you can give at willowchurch.com. It'll be on the screen at the break also. But don't forget to share the messages.
That's right.
On Wednesday, there was a really good one, you know.
Pastor was
talking about prescriptive and descriptive, messages in the Bible.
That's right.
And you really ought to go back and listen to that. It was really touching. It makes you want to go back and do a lot of research.
Yes, it does. Yes. And be sure to stay tuned again, because after worship, we're going to do a giveaway. And everybody loves a great giveaway, right? So mark your calendars, April 28th at 6 o'clock. We are going to have Encounter Night. And I love Encounter Night. Encounter Night is a time of worship, but we also have a guest speaker this time. His name is Matt Cruz, and I've been watching a couple of his messages, and they are powerful. So you don't want to miss it. April 28th, 6 o'clock. Be there. I know I will.
So Encounter Nights are always a big deal,
yes.
Right? I mean, everybody gets to come into that night when everybody has a lot of praise and worship.
Yes,
you know,
love it.
People are sitting back in the pews, you know,
hands up, laid out on the floor, all of it.
Up front,
that's right.
So wherever you're at, just getting ready for praise and worship time. Again, if you're out of town, you're at your house, wherever you're at, for our online family, you just want to get your heart right.
That's right.
And you know, we just want to enter in to worship with the Father. This is the best time to do it. And it doesn't matter where you're at. I mean, people are in their closets, people are in their backyards, wherever you can hear.
That's right.
And if you got your, you know, headphones on or whatever, we got one of the best worship leaders and a worship team here. So we'll be back here shortly at the break.
Yes,
Thank
we will.
Thank you for joining us. Sit back and enjoy.
See you in a few minutes.
Good morning, Willow Church. Would everybody stand up with me? There's like half of this room. Where's the other half, guys? When are they coming in? Okay. I guess I just want to pray, and I think we should just get into the Lord's presence this morning, because he's here, because this is his house. Psalms 104. We know it's said quite often, We enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. But I think it's said pretty often because it's a formula verse. When we give thanksgiving, we enter his gates. And when we give his praise, we enter his courts. But I have good news this morning, and it's that we have the opportunity to be in his house, not just on the outer gates of the courts. So Lord, if we can pray. Lord, we're just so thankful that we have the opportunity to be in your house. We thank you, Lord, that we're able to come and to worship you freely. Oh, Jesus, we just worship you. We thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice and everything that you did and you paid for on the cross and that you died to give us, Lord. We want to live it out. We want to live in abundance. We want to give you everything that you paid for. Lord, the reverence that we have and the awe that we have on Easter week is not something that can fade, but it is something that sticks and it stays, Lord. We worship you with the same reverence and awe today. We're grateful to know you. You've allowed us to know you. Our innermost being desires to worship you. That is who we are. We're designed to worship you. We have a purpose and a destiny just in that alone. Thank you, Lord. This morning, let us be undignified. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our ears to see you, to hear you. When did we not become undignified? Let us dance like David with all of our might before you, Lord. We have the opportunity on earth for this short time to show you how much we love you and to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory that you deserve. You deserve even more than we can offer, Lord. But this morning we join together to offer a joyful noise for you, Lord. Lord, we want to be uncomfortable. We want to give everything we have to you because you're worthy of it. You're worthy of us not saving face. You're worthy of us not looking pretty this morning. Oh, Jesus, you're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. We focus our eyes on you. Sometimes we can miss everything that's going on. Even when we're singing about him, we can miss him because we're so focused on ourselves, quite honestly. So, Lord, we just take the eyes off of ourselves and we want to look at you. We're in awe of you and who you are, not for anything that you can do, but what's already done. Thank you for your character, Lord. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your love that knows no bounds. You are so good. And that is why we worship you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We worship you this morning, Lord. You are here. You are in our midst. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Fill the temple, Lord. Rest here. Rest here in your house. This is your house. We are your people. Fill your people. Thank you, Lord, that worship does not rest on just these people up here, these wonderful people up here to lead us, but it rests on a people who are hungry and who are desperate to praise you. We are desperate to praise you this morning. We are desperate to praise you this morning. And if we're not, why are we here? We are desperate to praise you and to worship you and to give our hearts to you because you are worthy of everything we have and everything we're not and everything in between. Thank you, Jesus. Let us be undignified in our worship this morning and let us seek your face and let us go after your heart to please you. We were created to give you joy and to please you. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for residing here with us. Fill the room and do whatever you want to. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
redemption on the wind. Forgiveness like the tide rolling in, taking up the space where shame has lived. Receiving all that you died to give. Let the wind blow, let the tide roll, till the earth knows you're a God of love. Let my dry bones sing a new song, all the glory to the God of love. Hey!
Loves returning. Let the
Let the wind blow. Let the tide roll. Till the earth knows you're a God of love. Let my dry bones sing a new song. All the glory to the God of love. All the glory to the God of love. All the glory to the God of love.
Thanksgiving and with praise, we've come to adore, to join earth and heaven, to bless the highest name. Abba, Father, Elohim, King of kings. Abba, Father, be unto you. In the to God in the highest, who with every breath we will be singing, holy, you are holy. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Forevermore we will be singing, holy, you are holy.
Sweet Holy Spirit, thank you for your presence. We so welcome you. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We want to be sensitive to your voice. Speak to our hearts. Hallelujah. The deliverer's here. Hallelujah. He just wants to continuously upgrade you every single day. Upgrade you every single day. Hallelujah. And the way to be upgraded, to be pressed into his presence, Matthew 6 and 33 gives us the key. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and all of his righteousness, and everything else will be added unto you. But what the Holy Spirit showed me is that sometimes when he adds, subtraction happens. As he adds, things that need to be taken away are taken away. And as he adds, they're multiplied. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. And then he divides you from what you don't need to be associated with. Thank you, wonderful Holy Spirit. And so what many of you are experiencing is you're battling with issues, and you're putting and exerting all of your energy into fighting the issue. And he's saying, no, my child, I'm upgrading your press into my presence, and those things will fall off of you. Transfer that energy to pressing into me and stop battling with these things and look to me. And then he told me, there are addictions that I want to break. People have been victimized by the spirit of addiction. It's no shame to you, but if you will come right now, if it's a person, if it's pornography, if it's alcohol, if it's a chemical substance, if it's a prescription pill, whatever it is, he wants to free you right now. Thank you, Jesus. Be free in the name of Jesus. All of it goes. I command the spirit of addiction to leave you now. I thank you that your only addiction is the Holy Spirit, that you press into him for everything that you need. I command the spirit of inadequacy to leave you now. You are whole in Jesus. Go, go. I command you out. Go. In the name of Jesus. Come on, begin to open your mouth and say, thank you for freedom, Jesus. Thank you for freedom, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for her identity in you. Every false identity goes. No man defines you. Hamasheta. Thank you, Jesus. Free, 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 free. Go. I command you out. I command you out. Spirit of addiction, leave her now. Leave her now. In the name of Jesus. Come on, baby. Open up your mouth and begin to declare that you belong to Jesus and he is all that you need. In the name of Jesus, I don't need any substance. I don't need any person. All I need is you, Jesus. I command you out. Loose her and let her go now. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Be free in the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. I thank you, Lord, that you're sweeping away those holes in the soul and you are fulfilling her with the oil of honey. Hallelujah. The oil of joy. Hamashetaba. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that she finds her identity in you. No more wandering, no more circling, no more compassing around this mountain. In the name of Jesus, freedom at last. Freedom in the name of Jesus. I command the spirit of addiction to leave you now. Go, go, out. Go in the name of Jesus. I command you out. Get out right now in the name of Jesus. You have no rule in her life. All the territory that you've stolen, it be returned now in the name of Jesus. Peace robbed from you, return multiplied in the mighty name of Jesus. Those relationships that crushed you to your core, he's coming to mend the brokenness now. I thank you, God, that she leans on you, that her default is you. So I command you out in the name of Jesus. Out, 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 out. In the name of Jesus. Entirely out. You not holding on, devil. Your eviction notice is now. I command you out in the name of Jesus. Thank you for freedom in you, Lord. Thank you for freedom in you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Free. Free. In the name of Jesus. Find yourself in him. Run to his arms. Don't you battle it anymore. That pain, that abandonment, that suffering, don't you let it consume you anymore. I command you out. I thank you, God, for freedom. Spirit of addiction, leave her now. Leave her now. Out. Go. In the name of Jesus, I thank you, Lord, that her freedom is in you right now. We command you out. Loose your hold off of her life in the name of Jesus Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we command you out, 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 no more. We're not returning to it again. Egypt is the past. You're in Goshen. You have safety. You have acceptance. You have approval. He's covering you. Thank you, Jesus. Never again. Never again. Oh, thank you, God. I command this heaviness to go in the name of Jesus. And I command this off relationship tie, this soul tie, be destroyed in the name of Jesus. Her only craving is you. Hallelujah. Cleanse her spirit now. now. Cleanse her soul now. Take the scissors from heaven. Destroy the tie. Annihilate it. Crush it. In the name of Jesus, I thank you, Lord, that she looks to you for her acceptance and approval. Shadabasi, go. If there be anyone else, come now. Don't wait. The enemy wants to trick you into waiting. Thank you, Lord. You all celebrate them as they're coming. Thank you, God. The deliverer is here. I command the spirit of addiction to leave you now. In the name of Jesus, begin to open your mouth and say, Lord, I thank you for my freedom. Thank you for my freedom. And he's addressing those pains and issues that causes you to return to something other than him. No shame. All of the shame and embarrassment leaves you now. All of the guilt goes now. I thank you, God, that her identity is grounded in you. Freedom now. Brush the weight off of her shoulders. Let her give every burden to you, her family, God. Give it to you. She can't bear it alone. Thank you, Lord. I remove false pressure off of you now. In the name of Jesus, you're exhausting yourself trying to meet everybody else's need. And he's saying, give them to me. They have become your addiction. Give them to me. Let me fix it. Let me handle it. Surrender, 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 surrender. Out. No more. No more addictions, no more false soul ties, no more false burdens, no more false pressure. It goes, it goes, it goes. I command the spirit of failure to leave you now. The spirit of failure, I see you out, out in the name of Jesus. Get out now in the name of Jesus. Shanama, esteem restored to you. Esteem restored to you. Worth restored to you. In the name of Jesus. And we give you glory, God. We give you glory, God. We thank you, Father. Every addiction go. Every addiction go. Now, in the name of Jesus, be purged and clean. Now, out. No more faulty relationships. Oh, thank you, Lord. All of it goes. Just release it. Let him have it. Let him have it. Let him have it. I command you out, you lying devil, you out. She doesn't need a man to feel fulfilled. She doesn't need a man to have validation that comes in Jesus. But I hear the Lord say, I have the right man for you. Don't let your heart be closed down because of past hurts. Just give your heart to me and I'll show you who it is. I'll give you the guidance on who it is. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for freedom. Cut that tie, Lord. Cut it permanently in the name of Jesus. Thank you for freedom in this house. Thank you for freedom in her heart and her mind. I break generational curses in the name of Jesus. New legacy. Your son is not legend for no reason. It's a new legacy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Be free. Be free. Be free. Yotamashe. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Freedom now. Freedom now. I command every lying spirit to leave you right now. And I command the spirit of addiction to leave you now. In the name of Jesus, I thank you, God, that that taste leaves her mouth. Hallelujah. I command that taste out. In the name of Jesus. Go, go, go. Go out, out, out. New taste, new appetite, new desire, new desire. Thank you, Jesus. Free, free. The pressures of life, they've tried to take your very mind, but the devil is a liar. I command that addiction to worry. There's an addiction to worry over you, but I command it out. In the name, out. Go, go. In the name of Jesus, free, free. No more toiling, no more toiling, no more battling, free. Know who you are in me, says the Lord. Stop finding yourself in false pretensions of this world, subliminal messages of this world. Your beauty is defined in me. He beautifies the meek with his salvation. So right now, every lie that has ever been told to you concerning your identity, concerning your physical appearance, out in the name of Jesus. Out, 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 out. In the name of Jesus, accept his love. He is wrapping his arms around you. And just declare out loud, Jesus, your love is enough for me. It's more than enough for me. It's more than enough for me. We cancel every lie with the truth. Right now, in the name of Jesus, go. I command rest in the mind. Rest in the mind. All of the what ifs, all of those twists and turns that your mind takes where you just can't find peace, I declare the spirit of peace, and I command the spirit of confusion to leave your mind. In the name of Jesus, totally, solely belong to Jesus. Hallelujah. Addicted to Jesus. Addicted to Jesus. Hooked on J-E-S-U-S. Hallelujah. We give you glory. We give you glory. Thank you, wonderful God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's celebrate Jesus. There's one more. Thank you, Lord. Free. 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 Now, in the name of Jesus, out. Spirit of addiction, leave her now. Go. Out. Out. In the name of Jesus, be free. We declare freedom. Come on, y'all, declare freedom. Just say, be free in the name of Jesus. Be free. Shadaba. Out. 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 In the name of Jesus. Never to return. I thank you, God, for setting her free, destroying the yokes of bondages, even ancestrally. I see ancestral things that have come upon you by default, but today it goes. It goes. Every false lie, every false God, every false idol, it falls. In the name of Jesus, I give you glory, Lord. I thank you, God, for canceling the spirit of addiction over her life. It leaves. It leaves in Jesus' name. We give God glory. We give God glory. You stay here. Let the Holy Spirit work on you. Stay right here. Thank you, Jesus. Listen, we always have time for the move of the Spirit. So God, I give you glory. You are the deliverer. You want your people free and to stay free. So I thank you for the permanency of this deliverance here in this house, that addiction won't be wrestled with anymore. And there's some in here, Pastor, I'm almost done. There are some in here, you didn't come up because you're embarrassed, but there is a pornography addiction. You don't have to come up now, but if you did, okay, but I feel more. So you don't have to come up, but if you are struggling with pornography, you need to receive your freedom today and declare never again. And then listen, there are practicals that come with deliverance. So stop doing what you did. If you were hooked on a show, hooked on pornography, cancel the cable, cut off the stream, whatever the access point was, get rid of it. We're not gonna pray deliverance over you and you go back and reopen the door and then it's seven times stronger. Whatever the addiction was, be it a substance, a person, you need to cut them off today. Cut it off today. This is a warning. If it's a relationship, delete the number. I won't be talking to you anymore. I wish you well. We're done. We're done. If you need to change your number, change your number. Take the measures necessary to stay free. Now listen, the Lord will free you again, but your condition will be seven times worse. So let's not even go there, okay? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. How we adore you, how we love you, how we bless you. We give your name praise. Thank you for your tender care, your meticulous attention toward us. We love you, Jesus. Come on, declare the name of Jesus. 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 Ooh, hallelujah. We give you glory. Bless the name of Jesus. We praise you forever. Stay with us. Remain with us. Hold us tightly, Holy Spirit. Tighten your grip on us. Don't let us go. Don't let us go. We need you desperately. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Go hug a neighbor.
Wow, wow, wow. Freedom is in the house today, and freedom is also for you. Have you fully given the Lord all of your heart, every part of your heart, or is there one thing that feels like, Lord, you can have it all, but not this one thing? Today's the day. Today is the day to fully give it over to the Lord, amen, because freedom is in the house today. Last Sunday was Resurrection Sunday, and we have 12 people fully give their life over to the Lord in baptism. We had numerous salvations, healings, and deliverances. It was a powerful Sunday in the house, just like it's a powerful Sunday today. You've got to come. If you're local, you need to come because the power of the Lord is just indwelling on this house. And I want to mention, too, just a couple of highlights from Pastor's sermon last week. He said, what happened on the cross was justice and mercy kissed. I love that. He said Jesus gave his life to love, forgive, and to embrace sinners. Another one was heaven sees us through the blood of Jesus. And another one is sanctification is like when we're image bearers, when we act, look, and we live like Jesus. And it was just a powerful sermon. It was a powerful sermon. If you didn't see it, go back and catch the replay.
And you can't catch a replay. Everybody's reposting it, right?
That's
Which
right.
you should do, right?
That's
all our
right.
online family. Repost it on Facebook, YouTube, all of that.
That's right. You guys can repost as
okay,
well.
Okay, so here's the deal, online family. We have a giveaway. And the giveaway is going to be a cool Willow shirt.
That's right.
But first, we need you to email us at onlinecampus@willowchurch.com. Give us your name, your phone number, and your address, and your shirt size. And your phone number. And once we get that, we'll send that directly out to you. There is a few announcements that we have. So remember, we're a house of prayer.
That's right.
So Monday evenings from 6 to 7, we're here. And from Monday to Friday, 6:30 to 8:30, we're here praying in the morning. You know, Pastor said on Wednesday, you don't have to come the whole time, but just stop by. Get your prayer and get the presence on you and go out and, you know, out in the world and you'll be covered. The other thing is we have that we don't talk about much is our Willow men's team.
That's right.
They meet every second and fourth Sunday at 5 at the Panera Bread here in Lake Jackson. And then we have Midnight Cry on April 20th.
That's right. I love Midnight Cry. You want to be there. It's a great time to just feel that presence like the upper room. It's powerful. Okay, so today is Communion Sunday. So get out some bread or some cracker or some juice and join us as we relive what he did on the finished work of the cross, right? So 1 Corinthians says the covenant is the new covenant of his blood. And Jesus died to fulfill the requirements of the old covenant and usher in the new covenant. And the new covenant pours out his blessings of love, healing, forgiveness, and his presence. So I love Communion Sunday because it's like reliving Resurrection Sunday
right.
every single month, right?
Right.
Right, Pastor?
Listen, we don't have a lot of time, but I just wanted to bust it up because, you know, these are my people right here. These are amazing people, the Browns, online campus leaders. Listen, we just want to encourage you, get plugged in. God is moving in this service. Did you guys just see
amazing.
That? We had a little sword of spirit jump out. We didn't know what was going to happen. It was so good. People are being set free in the same anointing that is in this house. It is in your house. So just connect by the Spirit of God. It's not by might. It's not by power. If a person doesn't physically lay hands on you, you want the Holy Spirit to lay hands
Amen.
On you. So we're just excited about what God's going to do today, and I'm rushing, but today we're going to continue continue in our end time series. We are talking about the millennial reign, and we are talking about the last of the last days. Listen, guys, we're going to bring in some modern day prophecies to where we are right now, from the sacrifices in Israel to the rebuilding of the temple to the eclipse tomorrow to the red heifers. So much is happening in the world, and the message is you need to be ready. If you're not saved, the message is repent or perish. And so we're telling you right now, if you don't know Jesus, accept him as your Lord and Savior. This is a warning. It is the love of God. It is the mercies of God that even give us access to come back to the Father. And so we want to encourage you, get your notes ready, get your pen and paper ready. Danny, as Danny would always say, what do they need to do?
Whenever you hear watch this or here it is, get your highlighter out.
All right. We love you guys, and I'll see you in the pulpit. God bless you. They'll see you at the end.
We'll see you after the messages. Thank you, Pastor.
See you soon.
I'm sorry, I'll be busting.
That was great. That was a beautiful taste of what's to come.
I'll be busting it off.
Good morning, Willow. Let me see if I wanted to share this with you. But first, I always get confused about what I'm supposed to do next. So let me say this. Guests, we're so glad you're with us this morning. And we're so thankful that you decided to come here to Willow and worship with us and learn about the Lord. And Lord, I know that the Lord is moving and hearts and lives will be changed here today. And we just thank y'all for being here. If you would, please take the blue card in front of you, fill it out. We'd like a record of your visit. Also, if you have a prayer request, if you would like to be put on the mailing list, the text list, please fill out that card, put it in one of the boxes, either in the very back or out in the foyer. We'd love to get to know you and to put a record of your visit. So as I was doing Bible study this week, this prayer came up, and I'd like to change it to where it's talking about us corporately, not just me. But it's just, you know, we get so busy in our lives, sometimes we just forget to be thankful, you know, to just be thankful to the Lord for everything that he's done for us. And this is that prayer. So God, when we think about all that you have done for us, we are overwhelmed with thanks. You are so good and kind to us. Thank you for being our steady source of hope and joy. You are worthy to be praised at all times, in every situation, in Jesus' name. If the ushers would come forward, we'll go ahead and take up the offering. Let me pray. Dear Father, Lord, we just thank you for all that you do for us, for all that you provide for us. We thank you for Willow. We thank you for the worship and it takes a lot of people to make all this happen, Father. And we just thank you that you usher all this in. You're in control of all this. And we just thank you for all that. Lord, we lift up this offering as we get ready to worship you with our offering. Father, we just pray you'd bless it, multiply it, Father. And I pray it would directly change hearts and lives through this offering. And Lord, we just love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, come on, somebody, put your hands together for the Lord Jesus Christ. He's worthy, amen. Come on, you can do better than that. Come on, you're excited to be in the house of the Lord? Hallelujah. Spirit of the Lord is in this place, and we're just excited about everything that he's doing. They are passing the offering pans around, but as they're doing that, we're just going to get our Bibles and turn to Revelation chapter 20. Begin reading at verse 2 through 7. Revelation chapter 20. Begin reading at verse 2 through 7. I hear that baby. They're excited to be in the house of the Lord. Look at the out of the mouth of babes, God has ordained praise. So Revelation chapter 20, begin reading verse 2 through 7. As you guys are heading there, let me just give you guys a few announcements, okay? And so for our announcements today, join us for a powerful time in the presence of God at Encounter Night, April 28th. And we will have our special guest speaker, Matt Cruz. If you don't know his ministry, look him up. He's going to be amazing. He's just a young man of God, and he travels around, operates in healings, miracles, teaches the word, deliverance, just an amazing young man. And he'll be preaching at the morning services and at the night service. Also, One Church, One Day is this Monday, April 8th. Prayer guides are in the atrium. That is a day that we pray for 24 hours. And if you need more information, you can email nikki@willowchurch.com. Join us April 30th at the Pregnancy Help Center from 6 to 8 p.m. We will be performing various tasks within that center. It's a great time to connect and to give back and to serve on an outreach. Pregnancy Help Center is an amazing, amazing ministry that we sow into, and they've done so much work for Brazoria County. Okay, and then also, join us on Wednesday nights. We have a great time of Bible study. It's food, it's fellowship. Bible study meal starts at 5:30 p.m., and it's a time in the Word. If you have kids, we have kids ministry, youth ministry, and nursery. You don't want to miss Wednesday night. Somebody say Wednesday night. We've been teaching out of the Psalms for about the last 3 months, and it's just been so powerful. So join us on that night. It's your midweek refueling. And so you want to get in the house that night. Also, can my Bible study people make some noise? Y'all come to the Bible study? Come on here. Yeah. So it's great. You don't want to miss it. And then also Monday through Friday morning prayer from 6:30 a.m. to 8:30 a.m. And then Monday night prayer tomorrow from 6 to 7 p.m. And then last but not least, because this is a house of prayer. Somebody say it's a house of prayer. So it's all prayer, 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 prayer. Y'all pray too much. We don't pray enough. We haven't even gotten started. Okay. So we got 24 hours of prayer tomorrow. We got Monday through Friday prayer, 6:30 to 8:30 a.m. We've been going strong on that for almost a year. God meets us here in the morning. It is powerful. Monday night prayer, we did it since Lent last year. So we're over a year on that. And then also our midnight cry. Somebody say midnight cry. That is on April 20th. Mark your calendars. We are here at midnight, in the midnight hour, crying out to God for 3 hours. It's a time of corporate prayer. It is so powerful. You don't want to miss the midnight cry. So mark that on your calendars. For 3 hours, we sacrifice and we make it our priority to seek the presence and the face of God. Okay, let's stand up and let's read the word of God. I say it from time to time, but I don't have a whole lot of traditions in me, but one tradition I'm probably not going to ever shake is standing up to read the Word of God. It is holy, and I don't believe it's just a good book about God. I believe that it is the living Word. It's alive. Somebody say it's alive. We're going to see throughout this text how it is alive and how it is fulfilling itself every single day. Okay, so here we go. Revelation chapter 20, begin reading at verse 2. It says this: he sees the dragon, that ancient serpent who is the devil. Somebody say the devil. Or Satan. And bound him for 1,000 years. He threw him into the abyss and locked and sealed it over him to keep him from deceiving the nations anymore until the 1,000 years were ended. After that, he must be set free for a short time. Somebody say a short time. I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony about Jesus and because of the word of God. They had not worshiped the beast nor his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or their hands. Okay, they came to life and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. So there's this tribulation period, right? We talked about it a few weeks ago. And during this tribulation period, things are going to become increasingly wicked. The Antichrist is going to be revealed. The mark of the beast is going to be unleashed, right? And the mark of the beast will be some sort of mark on your hand or on your forehead. We're already in the pre-phases of that, where there is soft conditioning for that. Okay, that's the way you have to say it. It's not the mark of the beast, but we are seeing the shockwaves of what is about to come. Okay? So they're going to receive it on their hands, on their foreheads. And then there are many who are going to be beheaded and become martyrs in the tribulation. Right? Now, when Jesus comes back at his second coming, he's coming back with the saints who have already received their glorified bodies. Okay? In the mark of the beast and all of the tribulation, if you die during that period of time, the Bible says they're going to come back to life. Somebody say they're going to come back to life. And so they're going to become a part of the army of God, and they will also instantly receive glorified bodies. Are you with me? Okay, so they came to life, and they also reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. Here it is. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. Okay, so there are going to be some people who die after this situation where the martyrs come back to life. There will be people who die, but they will not come back to life in a glorified sense until the 1,000 years is complete. Okay? Now, this is the first resurrection. Somebody say the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who share the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. When the 1,000 years are over, Satan will be released from his prison. Somebody say, he's back. Yeah. All right, Spirit of the living God, do what only you can do, not by might and not by power, but by your Spirit. Father, we thank you for your word. It's a lamp to our feet. It's a light to our path. Father, I pray that as we go through your word, let your word go through us. And Father, I pray that you would bring revelation, illumination, insight, revelatory knowledge, God, on these end times. And God, our ultimate goal is that we will be watching and waiting, prepared to meet you when you come. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. All right, we're going to continue in our series, Last of the Last Days. Somebody say Last of the Last Days. But today we're going to talk about the millennial reign. So today we're going to talk from the subject, the millennial reign. Somebody say the millennial reign. All right. Now, when we look at the millennial reign and when we look at this last end time series, I just want to kind of start by giving a brief recap, and you can put that slide on. I want to start by giving a brief recap of these last several weeks because we were out of commission this past 2 weeks. We had Palm Sunday and then we had Resurrection Sunday. But I want to give a little bit of recap of where we were to bring us to where we currently are. And so we talked about over the last several weeks about how the people of God, they're going to be raptured out. This is going to be a crazy scene where at all of a sudden you're going to see the believers and then they're going to disappear. The Bible kind of gives a little information and it says it will be 2 grinding of the mill. One will be taken. One will be left behind. He says that there will 2 be lying in the bed. One will be taken and one will be left. And so it's talking about how literally it's going to be just like a day like today. And then there's just going to be a separation and then you'll have some people who are left. Some people are taken. The people who are left are those who did not make Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And so when you look at what will happen at the rapture, the believers will be taken off of the scene. Somebody say, taken off of the scene. This is no different than what God has done throughout history. We talked about pre-trib, mid-trib, and post-trib. Okay. Now, I am a pre-trib type of a guy. And the reason why is because I believe that there is the most biblical grounding to that belief, that stance. I believe that, number one, we see the pattern of God multiple times throughout the scriptures where he takes the believers off of the scene before his wrath or his judgment falls. We see that with the children of Israel in Egypt. We also see that with Noah and the ark, where he gives the believers, those who are considered righteous and put their faith in him, the opportunity to come into safety within the ark. And you see it also with Lot and Sodom and Gomorrah. Before the wrath of God is completely to destroy or to fall, he raptures the believers out of that situation. And so I believe that it'll be no different with us as we are approaching the great and terrible day of the Lord. And so the believers are raptured, and the Bible says in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Somebody say, in the twinkling of an eye, we'll be changed from mortals to immortal. We will take off and we will shed corruptible flesh and we will put on incorruptible flesh, because currently as we stand, our bodies cannot go to heaven like this. We don't have the composition or the chemical makeup to where we can withstand that level of glory of God. This is why the Bible says that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. This is why when Moses said, God, I'm hungry for more. Show me your glory. I want to see your face. God says, Moses, if I show you my glory, then I got to kill you. And I believe Moses said, that's all right. God, I really don't need to see you like that in order to believe you. Somebody said, just believe God. And so in other words, we can still extract from that, that in order for God, for Moses to see the fullness of God's glory, because we only see God in part, whether it's in a vision, whether it's in a dream, we don't see the full manifestation of who he is. You couldn't take it. Okay. And so what ends up happening is the believers, they're raptured out. But then God returns to the earth in a second coming. And in this second coming, so there's a difference between the rapture and the second coming. They're all a part of the same event, but at the second coming, every eye shall behold Jesus as he comes back on the cloud. He's going to come back on a white horse. He'll have eyes of fire. He's not coming as a lamb, but he's coming as a conquering king. The Bible says that he'll have a sword, which is the word of God. Somebody say the word of God. He's got something etched in his thigh. It's just a big scene. It's a big deal. And so he comes. It's a lot of drama with it. But he's coming to defeat those that are against God, which be the Antichrist, the false prophet, and the nations that have risen against God. Okay, so now when we look at that, the Antichrist will be defeated. The false prophet will be defeated, and the nations that are against God will be defeated. Now, again, the believers will be with Christ. Everybody gets a white horse. Somebody say, everybody gets a white horse. Some of y'all wanted to ride a horse all your life. You're going to get to. Okay, so everybody's going to get a white horse. We'll have robes that are clean and white, and it represents purity and sanctification, and that we have overcome. Somebody say, I've overcome. And then we just come from kind of moral support. Jesus is going to defeat the nations by a word. And then the nations are going to be defeated, and the birds he's going to summon to consume their flesh. Now, here we go with the millennial reign. We end up where Jesus sets up his kingdom in Jerusalem. Somebody say in Jerusalem. And this is the people who rejected God, because at the conclusion of the battle of Armageddon, it is just going to be Jesus. And the Bible says that they will look upon him whom they have pierced. Being Israel, looking upon their Savior. And I believe at this moment, all of Israel will be saved, according to the book of Romans. And so they're going to have remorse. They're going to have sorrow. They said they're going to mourn as a mother mourns for her child, because now they clearly realize we got this thing wrong forever. And this was our Savior the whole time. Now he's come and saved us. He's delivered us again. And at that point, they will realize that this is the true Messiah. Okay. Now, I just want to share a few things before we dig even deeper into the millennial reign. Somebody say millennial reign. Because right now there's a lot going on in the earth actually today. Tomorrow we got the eclipse, and we're going to talk about that a little bit because it is significant. When you look at everything that is happening in the earth, now I've already told you, I don't give dates and times, and if you're wise, you won't either. Because they've already said it's going to be 40 days out from the eclipse that the rapture is going to happen. They've missed it again. So here's the deal. I believe if God was going to come 40 days, he said, I'm changing it now. That's why I never gave a day. So the deal is that we want to talk about the signs and the prophetic signs and the symbols in the heaven, because as we talked about several weeks ago, Jesus took issue with the Pharisees and said, you can tell natural weather by the signs, but you can't tell the spiritual climate by what is happening in the earth. And so there is this expectation that we are to be watching and waiting patiently for the return of our bridegroom, just like the 10 virgins, 5 were wise and 5 were foolish. He is telling us to watch and wait. Somebody say, watch and wait. Don't be caught off guard. Don't get sidetracked. He says that the parable of the virgins, and I wanted to incorporate that whole parable. I wanted to just do a whole sermon on that, but I don't think we're going to have time because we got to move. But the deal is this. It is like when you look at the parable of the 10 virgins, 5 were wise and 5 were foolish, right? So they were all virgins, they were all pure, they were all clean, but not all of them got let into the party, to the wedding feast.
That's right.
Not all of them got let in, even though all of them were pure, virgin, clean, virgin, foolish, distracted, didn't make it. So they got locked out. They did. And the whole point of that, the parable, Jesus said, you better be watching, you better be praying, and you better be alert. We would be foolish to walk away from that warning and think we've got it all locked down. It would behoove you to take the instructions and say, okay, I'm actually going to watch. I'm actually going to wait. And I actually am going to be very careful with how I live my life and be sure that it is pleasing to God. In the parable, the way that he actually said it, he said the ones that were foolish, they weren't alert. They weren't watching or praying. Their lamps were not filled with oil and their wicks were not trimmed. And so oil is always symbolic of the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
Somebody say, be full of the Holy Spirit. Be full of the Holy Spirit. Lamps in biblical times also provided guidance and it would lead you. So as does the Holy Spirit do for us as believers. So he's saying, be full of the Holy Spirit so that it can lead and guide you in these perilous times. Because if you don't have the Holy Spirit and you're not full of it, it is going to be pretty much inevitable that you're not deceived. That's the message. That's actually the true message. If you're not full of the Holy Spirit and allowing him to lead you, the times have become so dark, so confusing, so diabolical that if the Holy Spirit is not your guiding light, you're going to probably be deceived. Somebody say, don't be deceived. Say, be full of the Holy Spirit. And so let's talk about some of these things because there are several signs that are occurring right now. And these signs that are occurring should actually just awaken us and cause us to recalibrate our heart. They asked Jesus for a sign in the Gospel of Matthew, and he said, I'm not going to give you a sign except for the sign of Jonah. This is significant, and it aligns with the eclipse tomorrow. Well, why do you say that aligns with the eclipse tomorrow? Well, Pastor, you're probably just a conspiracy theorist. You can stay asleep if you want to stay asleep. We're getting the sign of Jonah tomorrow.
Amen.
We're getting the sign of Jonah tomorrow. Now, when you look at the X, this is the pattern that the path that the eclipses have taken from 2017 to 2024. And ultimately, it kind of forms a giant X. And that X in the Hebrew, it is the Tav, which means final. Somebody say final. Okay, the eclipse is also going over 8 cities named Nineveh. Okay, this is significant because the word of the Lord was for Jonah to go to Nineveh, preach repentance, and as Nineveh would repent, they would turn their heart back to God. Now, Nineveh was a wicked and evil region. It was an evil city. They were pagan. They were vile. Everything that they were doing was anti-God. And Jonah was like, God, why you got to ask me to do it? Oh, I felt like Jonah before, right? Why I got to be the one to do it? You know, but you ask God to use you. You can't tell him how to use you. When you ask God to use you, you got to be an open check to say, God, however you want to use me, use me. Then when he tells you how he's going to use you, you can't complain about it.
That's right.
So then Jonah says, okay, well, I'm running from God. Somebody say, I'm running from God. We've all ran from God before at some point in our life. Some of y'all still running from God. And you know God has told you to do something and you won't do it. So Jonah gets, God says, you going to Nineveh? Kevin, he said, I ain't going to Nineveh because they're too evil. They're never going to believe me. There's nothing that I'm going to be able to say that is going to turn those hearts. Like, who in Nineveh is going to listen to me? And so ultimately, he gets on the first flight out of there, you know. It's a boat, but, you know, same thing. He catches the first ship out of there. He buys his tickets. He hides. And then, long story short, we know the story. He gets on there, and it's the worst storm of their life. It's a supernatural storm. God gets in the elements. All of the sailors who are on that ship, they know that this storm is supernatural. And they say, and these are pagans. Somebody say pagans. Now, listen, this is what I take issue with. Y'all know I'm always going to come for the church. Why is it that the unbelievers have more of an awareness when God is moving than the believers? These are the pagans. And they say, listen, we don't even believe in God, but I'm telling you, somebody has offended God. It's good to me, y'all. I could stay right there the whole time. They said, somebody has offended God. And Jonah's sleeping in the bottom of the boat because they knew this storm was supernatural because they were sailors, so they knew how to tell the weather. They knew when to go out, when it was going to be clear, same way we do now. And so they said, this is a supernatural storm. And ultimately, Jonah wakes up and he says, it's because of me that this storm is happening. Just throw me overboard. And they didn't want to throw Noah over the boat, right? Because they said, we don't want any blood on our hands. We don't want to kill an innocent man, which is noble. So he says, they said, we're not going to kill him. We're not going to kill him. They cast lots. They find out that it's Noah. And then there's no other alternative but to throw him overboard if this storm is going to stop. Bible says they threw him overboard and the storm ceased. Somebody say the storm ceased. Here's another principle. Listen, some of the worst storms you're going through in your life literally are because of who you have on your boat. Some of the worst storms that you will ever, I got a good witness back there. Somebody waving me down. Listen, I see you. Some of the worst storms, she said, amen, Pastor, amen. Listen, some of the worst storms you will ever go through in your life is literally because you have the wrong people on your boat. Why don't we ever want to throw Jonah off the boat? Because of emotional connection. Well, I've been knowing him so long. I done been through with Jonah. Let's just keep him. I'm telling you this, your storm is not going to ever stop until you get rid of those people that need to go. Never going to stop. Never going to stop. So they throw him overboard and immediately the storm stops. It was nothing holding up the storm. It had nothing to do with the sailors. It was all because of who they were carrying on the ship. Okay. So they got rid of the wrong person. Somebody said, get rid of the wrong people. I'm telling you, you got to get rid of these wrong people. And I don't know why I'm parking here, but I'm helping somebody. Listen, you got to get rid of these. Let me not say that. Okay. You got to get rid of the wrong people, because until you get rid of the wrong people, God is not going to send you the right people. Yeah. You are holding on to these people because of fear, because of comfort zones, because of emotional ties, because they've been here so long, because of the unknown of what's next. And I'm telling you, once you release it and allow God to purge it and cleanse it, he will fill it with exactly who he's called to be on your boat. So I just speak over you, divine connection, strategic relationships, sovereign setups, and holy hookups. Somebody say holy hookups. That God is going to hook it up. All right. So that will only happen once you make the move. This is what I preach all the time. It's not going to just happen because God desires it. God didn't desire for the sailors to be in the storm. They had to make a move. Somebody say make a move. And then God will come in. Okay. So anyway, this is what happens. And we got to get through this because he ends up getting swallowed up by the whale, okay? Then he gets dropped off it. The whale vomits him up in Nineveh.
That's right.
He is vomited up on the shores of Nineveh. He goes to this place, and people would say, you know, well, what was it that caused Nineveh to repent? Because they repented, okay? Why would this pagan island, who is extremely vile and wicked and all of this debauchery, believe Jonah? Well, this is what historians and astronomers say. This is not in the Bible, but I believe it. They say that when Noah showed up with the message of repentance, Jonah, thank you. When Jonah showed up, y'all know I'll be crisscrossing it. When Jonah showed up with the message of repentance to ancient Nineveh, theologians, historians, and astronomers say that Nineveh experienced and witnessed a full solar eclipse. And they are certain, it's not in the Bible, but they are certain that this happened. They actually give a date of June 15, 763 BC. So it would be like this. Ancient Mesopotamia, which is the region that he was in, the Assyrian culture, they believed that eclipses were signs of misfortune. They were bad omens. They were supernatural. Like if the sky goes black and there's a total eclipse, they believe this was a bad omen. This was a dramatic manifestation. And so in other words, this is just a supernatural power. God, Jonah comes in and says, repent, turn your hearts back to God, turn from your wicked ways, and boom, the sky goes black. Everybody repented. Because that's what they needed. That's where their mindset was. Okay? So this is what's happening tomorrow. And I don't think it's a coincidence. Anytime Jesus says, I'm not going to give you a sign except the sign of Jonah, and we got this eclipse going over eight cities called Nineveh, which that means repent. Somebody say repent. It's going over eight cities called Nineveh, plus it is the sign of what historians believe was the sign of Jonah, because it is a total eclipse for over 4 minutes, and this hasn't happened in over 2,000 years. Not to that length and extent of time. Okay? So it's a warning. It's a warning to repent and turn your hearts back to God. Somebody say, turn your hearts back to God. So we got the X, which is the Tav in Hebrew, which means final. This could mean that it is God's final warning to repent. God's saying, turn your hearts back to me. It is crossing over the eight cities. Now, beyond that, there's something else that is extremely unique. And I don't know how the Holy Spirit is going to roll with this, because I don't even want to land in this long. I just wanted to do this for 3 or 4 minutes, but it didn't work out. Somebody said it didn't work out. About 15 minutes. But here's the deal. Probably about 4 or 5 weeks ago, when I started studying all of this stuff, I was reading it, and I've made it no secret. Like, if God came today, I'm ready. Somebody say, I'm ready. But I ain't in a hurry either. I'm just being honest. Maybe you are, but I'm not. Okay? So I'm not in a hurry, but if he comes, I'm ready. So now here's the deal. I was thinking, like, Lord, you know, it looks like we got a little time, because I'm researching and I'm digging all this stuff out. And it literally says that the Antichrist, he's going to be revealed. And then it says that he is going to stop the daily temple sacrifices. Somebody say, stop the daily temple sacrifices. So literally in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, it says he will confirm a covenant with many for a week. So he's talking about confirming a covenant, a peace treaty with Israel for a week. Then it says in the middle of the week, which is actually 7 years, so 3.5 years in, watch this, he's going to put an end to daily sacrifices and offerings. And when I read that like a month and a half ago, when I was studying for this, maybe 6 weeks ago, I said, okay, so there is no temple. Right. If there's no temple, then there's no sacrifices. Right. I said, Lord, we got some time. I'm just saying, y'all can call me Cardinal if you want to. That's just what I said. I said, Lord, we got some time, right? And so it says he's going to put an end to sacrifices. There is no temple. And I looked it up. There hasn't been sacrifices in Jerusalem in over 2,000 years. So I said, that's a ways off. I said, we got some time. We're not even nowhere near that. Somebody say, Pastor was wrong. Okay. And then it says, and at the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. Now, here's the deal. When we look at what is about to happen, the temple is in the process of being rebuilt, actually. Not physically, but the temple construct, blueprints, those are all being worked on at templeinstitute.org is where you can get more information on that. They already have exactly the three most important items for the new temple, which are in accordance with biblical specifications. So they have the golden altar for incense, they have the table for showbread, and they have the menorah, which is made of 24 karat gold, exactly to biblical specifications. These items are ready to go for when the temple is rebuilt. Then I started to look at sacrifice, and I said, okay, ain't nobody about to burn no animals, not for no sacrifice. I don't believe it, right? But they are, okay? Now, here's the deal. When you look at the Bible, it gives specific specifications for how a temple is to be rebuilt. And if you look in the book of Numbers, it talks about how the red heifers have to be burned. And you take the ashes and you cleanse and you sprinkle them on the priests and you sprinkle them where the temple is to be built for purification. It is like a ritual. It was God's ordinance under law. Well, the Jews are still functioning under law because they don't believe Jesus came. So they are going to bring red heifers. And I said, as I was looking into this, I said, well, Lord, the Lord loves Texas. The Lord loves Texas, because here's the deal. They have already shipped 5 unblemished, spotless red heifers from Texas to Jerusalem. Yeah. Next slide. They have already shipped 5 unblemished, spotless red heifers from Texas. I don't know why Texas, but God picked Texas. to Jerusalem. And watch this. Not only have they shipped them from Texas to Jerusalem, but they already have built the altar that they are to be sacrificed on. They have already built the altar that they are to be, and it has to point in the direction that the new temple will be built in, okay? Now, this sacrifice of animals is supposed to take place between Passover and Shavuot, between April 20th and June 13th, my birthday. God loves me. Between April 20th and June 13th are the dates where these unblemished red heifers are to be sacrificed. Roll the video. Let's show them the altar.
Red heifer without defect or blemish, and that has never been under a yoke. Only then can the temple rise again. Caring for them on an Israeli settlement in the West Bank is Yitzhak Mamor.
So we have here, after the long research, we find them in Texas.
And 7,000 miles to Israel.
This is not a publicity stunt.
What do you mean?
Meaning, this is something you take very seriously.
Harry Potter is a good story. The Bible is not a story. The Bible is a way of God to lead us.
A massive altar already awaits where the heifers are to be burned.
According to some believers, the ceremony needs to be performed right here on the Mount of Olives, looking directly into where the temple once stood.
Yeah, deep. That's good. Somebody say, Jesus is coming. Okay, so there's a convergence that's happening in the earth. And so I wouldn't ignore the signs because it's closer than what you think. You just don't know. So you got to be ready. Somebody say, be ready. Okay, so we know that there's been war in Israel with Hamas and Israel. What we don't know, what has not been publicly broadcast, is really a big part of that war, at least a segment of it, has actually happened because of the red heifer situation. So the reason why this conflict happened in this way, and you can do your research, and if you dig deep enough, you'll see it, is because of the Jews' desire to build a third temple where there's a Muslim-controlled temple, Al-Aqsa Mosque, and it currently stands there. And so the Dome of the Rock and also Al-Aqsa Mosque are amongst the holiest sites in Israel today, and only Muslims are occupied inside, okay? So when you perform these acts and you bring these red heifers and you point them in that direction and you say we're going to burn them, they know what that means. It's basically like we're about to build this temple whether you like it or not. So by literally triggering that, bringing those red heifers, it is like it is the kickoff to the big event, which is literally like kicking a hornet's nest. And so that is really a big part of why this war was incited. When you look at the Jews don't currently accept Jesus as the Messiah. And so the Jews believe that this act will bring the Messiah. Only problem is he already came. So the deal is the Messiah that comes is going to be a false Messiah or a false Antichrist, or an Antichrist.
That's right. That's right.
False Jesus, false Messiah, or what we call the Antichrist. So they're going to be deceived. That's how they're going to be deceived.
That's right.
Because now it really is setting the stage for the Antichrist to rise in power. So we only have a little bit more. So, you know, here's the deal. I don't know when he's coming back, but it could easily be within the next 3 to 6 years based off of what's going on now. It doesn't take 2 decades to build a temple. So it's going to set the stage for the Antichrist to rise into power. And this is how everything gets kicked off. This is how they befriend the Antichrist. And then Jesus will come and defeat him. Somebody say he'll come and defeat him. So what happens is this. It really sets the stage for the millennial reign. After the Battle of Armageddon, then the believers, the saints, the martyrs, those that have returned with Christ or come back to life will then rule with Jesus on the earth. Now, when we look at the purpose of the millennial reign, why did God ordain and decree the millennial reign? It is so that his eternal plan would be 1,000 years and the Son of Man would rule with absolute sovereign control and perfect righteousness. So it really reinstates what God's original intention was. There's going to be this 1,000 years of complete peace, complete righteousness. It also will vindicate Jesus, because when Jesus came, he came for the Jews. He came as the leader of Israel. The Bible says that when the Magi came, or the wise men came to offer gifts to Jesus, they said, "Where is the king who has been born of the Jews?" When Jesus died on the cross, there was a sign that was posted above the cross that said, "King of the Jews." Somebody say, "King of the Jews." And so in the millennium, he will finally claim his throne as king, and he will receive all the glory that is due to him. And he will not only rule over Jerusalem, but he will rule over all the nation. So it vindicates God's plans. Now, here's the deal. In the very beginning, the Bible clearly tells us that it was the will of God that mankind would rule, reign, subdue, and have dominion over the earth. That is in the book of Genesis, it's in Hebrews, and it is in Psalms, where that was the mandate given to humanity. Now, because of sin, we were beguiled by the serpent. We dropped the crown, and it had to be recovered by humanity, which was Jesus. Jesus recovers the crown, and in so doing, he fulfills this prophetic word. Now, we preach this all the time, but we say that we lost that dominion in the fall. The earth came under a bend. Sin entered into the earth. Now we're no longer created in the image of God, but we're born in the likeness of Adam. But because Jesus came and died, that is restored back to us. Somebody say, "It's restored back to us." So now we are born again. Nicodemus said, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said, "You have to be born again." Somebody say, "Born again." He was confused that, how can I enter into my mother's womb a second time? That word "born again" comes from a Greek word, geneo, which is where we get the word genetics. So he's literally saying, when you say you got to be born again, he's saying you got to be regenerated. He said you got to be regenerated. Somebody say, "Born again." So it is a second birth. This is a new birth. You are a different human. He did not upgrade your nature. He created an entirely new nature. This is why we say new creature with new features. This is why I can confidently say, if nothing you're doing or saying is in alignment with the word of God and you call yourself a believer, you are not. You're not. Can't be. Because that's the old nature. Now, this doesn't mean you won't have struggles. This doesn't mean you won't wrestle with things. But it means that when you fall short of the glory of God and you miss the mark, there's got to be conviction there. That's the sign that there is a new nature, because the old things that I used to do, I can't comfortably do them anymore. That's a different me. Y'all too quiet on that one. Okay, so here's the deal. When you look at what we're talking about, you're born again, you take on a new nature, the seed of Christ comes on the inside of you, you're born of the Holy Spirit, just like Jesus was born of the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus, God, and the Holy Spirit gave mankind dominion in the very beginning, right? But even though we know we're in Christ, how many of you know that there are still some areas that you need to grow in and that you need to conquer? Okay. Now, here's the deal. Because of Christ, we got legal access. Somebody say, "Legal access to authority and dominion." Now, as long as I've been preaching this, the concept, I've been preaching this concept for a very long time, which is kingdom authority. Somebody say, "Kingdom authority." But I have never read this verse. At least I read it, but it didn't stand out to me until last week. And here it is in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 8. You want to write this down because this is a good one. It says this: "Put all things in subjection under his feet." God says that he put all things, somebody say all things, in subjection under his feet. So this is what God did for humanity in the beginning. We lost that and we got out of control. Jesus came back and God put all things under his feet. Listen to this. So if we're in Christ, that means all things are under our feet. He says, "All power and authority in heaven and earth has been given to me." Now the church literally rests in that power and authority because we are in Christ. Somebody say, "We're in Christ." We're seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. Now watch what Hebrews 2 and 8 says. Even though God put all things in subjection, and I want to tell you, all means all. You can't look up no Greek and Hebrew for that. It's just all. He put all things in subjection under his feet. That is the feet of mankind. But watch this. But now we do not yet see all things subject to him. Wow. That's really good. Because it's saying, listen, positionally and legally, through Jesus Christ, everything has been put under your feet. That's good news. In Christ, you have access to healing. You have access to dominion. You have access to breakthrough. You have access to abundance. You have access to prosperity. But there still are times that we are challenged because we live in a fallen earth and we are in decaying bodies. So just because you are in Christ and you're a believer and you love God and you're full of the Holy Spirit, it still doesn't mean that the enemy is not going to try you. Because you are in his system. But the deal is, when he comes to you, if you apply the word of God, the blood of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit, that can be under your feet right now. Not tomorrow, right now. Because the Bible clearly says, today, somebody say today, is your day of salvation. So that is your legal rights. Like, it could hold up in a court of law. The enemy has no legal rights to you. So like, if we had to present our evidence in court, and there's a court in heaven, if you had to present your evidence today, you win your case if you know the book. Yeah. Issue is, we don't fully know the book and we don't fully believe it. I was teaching this stuff to my son. I don't know where I'm gonna end up at, guys, because I'm supposed to be moving on, but I can't. I was teaching this stuff to my son the other day, and y'all know Jackson's really smart. And Jackson said, Dad, tell me how faith works. Tell me how faith works. And so I'm like, okay, so we sit down, we have a little Bible study, I'm telling him how faith works. And he said, because Jackson be praying for people, and sometimes they're healed. And they come back and they'll tell me and my wife, we got healed, your son prayed for us. And he said, why sometimes I pray for people, they heal, and then sometimes they're not healed? Oh, he's too smart. I hate those questions. Like, come on. I was like, why are you asking me that stuff? But it's a good question. And so I said, well, Jack, it's a lot to that. That's a loaded question. But here's one component. Somebody say one component. One. It's not a one size fits all. This isn't the situation every time. And just take that and rest. Somebody say rest. Yes. Okay. I said, but a lot of times, it's a lack of faith. I said, and this generation does not like to hear that. And I don't know where it went wrong. But I told Jack, I said, Jesus rebuked the disciples' lack of faith often. Yeah. Often. And we are supposedly following the same Jesus. But if you rebuke the disciples' faith today, they will get up and leave or get offended. Yeah. It's different. It's different. Yeah. It's different. We're easily offended. We have very thin skin.
That's right.
But Jesus would often say, with an attitude. Oh, ye of little faith.
Yes.
Why did you doubt? How long do I have to tolerate this faithless generation? Talking to the church.
Yes.
We got to be soldiers now. All of this weak, wimpy stuff has to go.
Yes.
We are going to have to apply the biblical principles of the word of God. And it's not an indictment against anybody, because I don't see anybody on earth walking in miracles, healing, signs, and wonders to the degree of Jesus. So you are not alone. It's all good. And this includes myself. I said, so Jack, a lot of times it's a lack of faith. I said, you see this in the story with the apostles when they tried to pray for the demon to come out of the boy. I said, and it didn't come out. I said, and then they go to Jesus and he immediately gets the demon out. And the disciples, you got to love them. They say, well, Lord, why couldn't we do what you did? I said, Jack, the first thing is they had an expectation that it should be happening every time. Because if they didn't, they would have never took them to Jesus. They would have just said, well, maybe it wasn't God's will to deliver this person.
Yeah.
They would just say, well, you know, we're not Jesus, so it doesn't always happen with us. They said, no, Lord, why can't we do what you did?
Right. That's right.
And Jesus said, this kind will not lead except by prayer and fasting, which means there are some things in your life that will not move, watch this, until you fast.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some things in your life will not release until you fast.
Yes.
So we are to live fasted lifestyle. Somebody say fasted lifestyle. You can't wait for a storm and then you move.
That's right.
If Noah would have waited for it to start raining to build the ark, it would have been too late.
That's right.
So you're going to have to already be there by living a fasted lifestyle was the message to that.
Uh-huh.
And so I told Jack, I said, sometimes it's a lack of faith. And he said, well, I feel like I have faith. I'm telling you, Jack's smart. I got to do something with him. He said, well, I feel like I have faith, and I don't feel like the people who get healed, I don't feel like I have more faith with them than the other ones who don't. Y'all get that boy. Y'all get him. Y'all get that boy. He's literally asking all the hard things, and it all makes sense. So I said, Jack, here's the deal. I said, I think I can get it. I think I can get you. I said, so here's the deal. When you look at it, if somebody said, I'll give you $1 million if you can tell me your full name, you would confidently say, my name is Jackson Maurice Snodgrass, and nobody can tell you different.
Uh-huh, that's right.
Because he has full confidence and assurance that that is his name, and he knows that he knows that he knows his name like he knows that I'm his father.
That's right.
Yeah. I said, now you see how confident you are about that $1 million? You can't lose because you know your name. I said, now, if I say pray for that person with cancer, and if you know they're going to get healed, I'll give you $1 million, but if they're not, you have to give me $1 million. Uh-huh. He said, I wouldn't do it. I said, and that's why they're not gonna get healed.
That's right. You gotta know.
You gotta know it.
You gotta know it.
Somebody say, you gotta know it. Because faith is substance.
That's right.
Faith is a substance of things hoped for. Yeah. It is evidence of things not seen.
That's right.
He could easily say, I'll wager $1 million for my name, but I wouldn't wager it for somebody I pray for to get well. That's because he doesn't know it. He believes it. It's high wishing. It's hopeful expectations. But it's not a deep conviction like the other one. But Jesus said you have to have faith and not doubt in your heart.
That's right.
Doesn't take a whole lot of doubt to counteract faith. He says if you have the faith the size of a grain of mustard seed, you can move a mountain. So if it takes the grain of a mustard seed to move a mountain, it takes a grain of a mustard seed of fear and unbelief to counteract that faith. Doesn't take much. So when we look at the millennial reign, somebody say the millennial reign. What ends up happening is this. Jesus is reigning on his throne. Believers are reigning with Jesus. We have the marriage supper of the Lamb, and we are ruling over nations. There was a passage in the Gospels where the disciples talked about what would happen in the new earth and where would their part be. And he says some will rule over 5 nations, some will rule over 10 nations. So where you rule and how you're positioned is literally based off of what we're doing right now. I told y'all about 4 weeks ago, if you live raggedy, but you end up making it, right? And then your works are bad. You may be in the millennial reign, but you're going to probably be a street sweeper. But you'll be singing. Somebody say you'll be singing. You'll be happy. You'll be happy. But what you do now will determine your rewards later. So he says some are going to rule over nations. Now, here's the deal. What is the setup of the millennial reign? Who's on the earth? Now, this will blow your mind. Here it is. This will blow your mind. And this is hard to wrap your mind around. But there's going to come a time, not too far from now, when all this stuff happens, where we will literally be on earth, not heaven. We will be on earth. And there will be people on earth in physical bodies, just like we have now, that are fallen. Fallen bodies, not glorified bodies. But at the same time, there will be people on earth, us, who will have glorified bodies. So you got two things working, and that's hard to imagine. Could you imagine now we don't have natural governors and mayors and sheriffs, but the governors and mayors and sheriffs and people who sit in offices are believers, but they are like supernatural beings?
Yes.
It would be like all of those seats now are occupied by angels for us to understand it. We are not angels. It's not the same thing. But just so you can get a picture of it, these supernatural, powerful, celestial beings are sitting in natural offices.
Yes.
Everybody will see Jesus as he is.
Yes.
Jesus, the earth will be under a theocracy.
Uh-huh.
Jesus will be a dictator.
Yes.
Some of y'all don't like that. Jesus will be a dictator,
and he will rule with righteous judgment. It will not be a democracy. It will not be voting in your favorite candidate. It will not be voting rights, and this is in the hands of the people where everybody gets to say in a decision. This is going to be a supreme rule and reign by Jesus Christ himself. Good news. Really, really good news. And so this is what will happen now. Jesus, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 27, that Jesus will rule with a rod of iron. Uh-oh, what happened to y'all nice Jesus? Jesus will rule with a rod of iron. That reminds me of my parents. They're gonna rule with a rod of iron. That means he ain't taking no mess. That means he ain't taking no mess. Now here's the deal. The people on earth will be those people in regular bodies who accepted the Lord after the tribulation. Okay? So these were people who accepted the Lord after the tribulation, who survived the tribulation period. And during this period of time, the people who accepted the Lord, they will still have free will. This is hard for us to understand. But they will still have a right to choose God or to not choose God because they are in a physical body.
That's right.
Okay? Not only will they have a right to choose God or to not choose God, but they will also bear children. Somebody say they're going to bear children. So the earth will continue to function in a natural way. The people will bear children, the people will work, the people will build houses, they will do all of these things. And the enemy during this time, Satan, will be locked up for 1,000 years. So there will not be the temptation of sin. Somebody say, no temptation of sin. The people will live very long. So here we go. It really is going to look like the Garden of Eden. It's not fully restored yet, but it is very reminiscent of the Garden of Eden. What do you mean by that? I mean, sin is not gonna have dominion. So there's gonna be sin because people are in their physical bodies, but sin will not be expressed in that way. People won't be robbing, they won't be stealing, they won't be killing, because it is under the rule and the dictatorship of Christ, and he is ruling with righteous judgment with a rod of iron. Now, the believers are the reinforcers in each of those cities and states and regions and nations. The believers, us. Okay? Now, watch this. It says this in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 21, in regards to the millennial reign. It says, and they shall build houses. So people are going to be building houses. They're going to be doing work, just like Adam would have been working in humanity in the beginning. It says, and they're going to inhabit them, and they shall plant vineyards. Somebody say, plant vineyards. And eat of the fruit of them. They shall not build and another inhabit, which means nobody's going to steal your stuff.
So good.
Nobody's going to break in your house. There's going to be a supernatural component to this where people could rebel in their hearts. You know how like people will be on your team and they act like you're with you, but they're not really with you.
Yes.
It's in the heart. So it's not expressed.
Uh-huh.
It is not done in an overt way. It is a covert way. It is the underbelly of it that will be alive, where people in their hearts, because the children are being born. So they're going to be generations continuously being born for 1,000 years, many, many, many generations. At that time, you will get to see your great, 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 great grandkids because you're not going to die. And it's possible to die. And we'll cover that in a minute. But by and large, if you are a believer and you obey God, you're not really going to die during that 1,000-year period in a physical body.
So good.
I know, I know. But really, to understand that, that's how it was in the beginning.
That's right.
The issue that caused all of this drama was sin.
That's right.
So once sin is taken out of the scene, and when we talk about sin, we're not just talking about stealing, killing, lying, cheating, manipulating, even though that stuff does aid you and bring death too. It's not just that. Poisonous chemicals and our food is because of sin.
That's the truth.
GMOs are because of sin. So those things is because of greed. It's because of money, chemicals, messing up our ozone. All of these things are causing cancer and they're causing us to die slow deaths daily. That's going to be gone.
Yeah.
So you're going to come back to the original intention. Somebody say the original intention. Okay, so it says that you're not going to build in another inhabit. You're not going to plant in another eat. For as the days of a tree are the days of my people. Trees live like thousands of years, hundreds, thousands of years. He said, like the days of the tree, that's how the days of my people are going to be. He says, and my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. So he says, listen, you're going to be working, but it's not going to be laborious. You're going to be building and planting, but it's not going to be like now if we go take 8 hours and then we end up in the sun and we can't breathe. And then the next day we can't even move. He said, no, it's not going to be like that. He said, this is going to be work and labor that you enjoy. Isaiah 65 and 20, it says this. No more shall there be an infant who lives but a few days. There's not going to be any more spontaneous abortions. You're not going to lose your child. Kids are not going to die at a young age. He says, or an old man who does not fill out his days. For the young man shall die at 100 years old. So in the millennial, when somebody dies at 100, they're going to say, they die way too young. Yeah. Come on, somebody. That ought to make somebody happy. They're going to say, how did they die at 100? Somebody dying at 100 will be like a one-year-old dying now. That's how that's going to be. And that is because there is no sin. And the Bible says in that same passage, when people die at 100, they're going to say they were judged and they were cursed. Because you will be able to die. That's just not the setup. So if there is rebellion against Jesus, ruling with an iron of rod, you're out of here. We're going back to law in that way. So he says that when somebody dies at 100 year old and the sinner 100 years old shall be accursed. So he's saying there was some type of sin and there was some curse that made them die at 100 because they're supposed to live way longer than that. Okay? Not only that, now I'm going to say this and y'all going to get mad at me, and I know y'all are, but it's okay. When you talk about the original intent and how God set this up, there is going to be where we, the animals that are on the earth, they're going to be friendly and at peace. So we're talking about everything being under our feet and having dominion over everything, even the animals, right? That's how it originally were, where Adam could go up to the animals and name, he could go up to a lion and name him and say, I think you're gonna be a lion. And he's like, okay, and he walks away. There was no enmity between man and creation. Yeah, right. There won't be a poisonous snake in the millennial reign that's going to try and lash out at you and inject you with him. That's not happening anymore. Yeah. Creation is going to be at rest, and we're going to see the full authority and dominion of mankind over creation.
That's so good.
Okay? Now, here's the part. Not only will animals not hurt each other, but we're not going to hurt animals, mm-hmm. which means we're not going to kill animals.
That's right.
Which means you're going to be eating plant-based. I'm just telling you. It's in the Bible. Now, here it is. I told you I wasn't going to like it. I told you I wasn't going to like it. But here's the deal. You got to look at it like this, and I know it sounds comical, and I'm not pushing an agenda because it's not a sin to eat meat now. I hope you guys are not too connected to it, but here's the deal. Genesis 1 and 29, here we go. Then God said, behold, I have given you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the earth and every tree whose fruit contains seed. They will be meat for you, M-E-A-T. They will be your food. God said, I've given you plants, vegetation, and fruit, and that's your diet. That was the original diet of mankind. No animal was killed and no man ate a beast until the fall.
That's true.
Prove me wrong. Send me an email. No man ate a beast until the fall. That's very biblical. Now watch this. Some people do know that. But here's the second part of that. And to every beast, Genesis 1 and 30, every beast of the earth and of every bird of the air and every creature that crawls upon the earth, everything that has the breath of life in it, I have given every green plant for food, and it was so.
That's right.
Heavy. That means a lion was eating grass.
Come on.
A lion was eating fruit. A wolf was eating vegetation.
and say, well, Pastor, I still don't believe it. Well, I mean, it's not up to me. This is just the Bible. This is what I'm telling you. Everything's getting restored back to the original intent. God's original intention is always his ultimate conclusion. So we're going back again. Somebody say back again. Oh, I see y'all. Some of y'all are cringing and manifesting. They're saying, don't touch my steak. Don't touch my ribs. We're Texans. It just is what it is, and you're not going to miss it. God never gives us less. You go into more. You go into more. Now, here's the deal. That is also affirmed and validated because in Isaiah 65, 25, it says this. It says, the wolf and the lamb, watch this, the wolf and the lamb will feed together. They're, a wolf is supposed to eat a lamb. It said they're going to look at each other and they both going to start eating grass. They're going to feed together. He says, watch this, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. Deep. It's all going to change back to how it was. So God gives us the picture because there can't be killing because that comes from sin.
That's right.
It can't be killing. That comes from sin. So he says the lion's going to eat straw. Can you imagine? Lion got these big old canine teeth and he's eating straw.
Yes.
And you can go up to him and pet him.
Yes.
Lion will eat straw like the oxen. The dust will be a serpent's food, and they will neither harm nor destroy them on the holy mountain, says the Lord. So what we have is this. The believers will occupy. The believers will rule the nations. Christ will rule with an iron fist, a rod of iron. He's not going to tolerate sin or unrighteousness, but something in the hearts of humanity, because just because, and I know this is hard to understand. This is hard to understand. How do you get raised in an environment where Jesus is physically on earth as the president?
Yeah.
And you still don't believe?
Yeah. Yeah.
The saints are ruling over nations in celestial, supernatural, glorified bodies.
Yeah.
But there will still be people who rebel.
Yes.
Listen, let me tell you this. It doesn't matter what God does or how he extends himself or how he shows his hand. There will always be people who are doubting what God is doing.
That's right. That's right.
Always.
That's right.
Doesn't matter how much fruit is there. Doesn't matter how much presence of God is there. You can physically see Jesus.
That's right.
Yeah.
And some people will still not believe. Well, how do you prove that? Because the Bible says when Jesus ascended into heaven, there were people on the mountain watching his ascension who still didn't believe.
Still didn't believe. That's right.
It doesn't matter. People will still not believe. And some of you know that because you may have raised your child or your children in a godly home and they completely rebelled against the atmosphere of godliness.
Yes. Yes.
You don't always control it that way. So there will still be people who are in rebellion. Somebody say rebellion.
Rebellion.
Okay. So what ends up happening is this. The church is Christ's administration. We carry out his order. He will not tolerate acts of ungodliness. He will rule with a rod of iron. The whole world will go up to Jerusalem once a year to worship Jesus, to see him and witness him there. But what ends up happening is this. He says that in the conclusion of the millennial reign, 1,000 years, and the band can come, worship team can come. He says that at that 1,000 years, Revelations 1 and 20, he says, when the 1,000 years are completed, somebody say completed.
Completed.
Satan will be released from his prison. Oh, no. Here he comes again. Lord, why would you release him again? There is a final time of testing, and it says for a short time.
Uh-huh.
And when the 1,000 years are completed, Satan will be released from his prison and will come out, watch this, to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for war. The number of them is like the sand of the seashore. Okay, so listen, the earth has become fully populated again. I mean, you literally got such a chunk of the earth wiped out with Armageddon and the nations and the enemies against God. And now over this 1,000-year period, it's going to be just as populated as what it is today. Okay? He says, like the sands on the seashore, that will be how the population of the earth is. but you didn't have any blatant acts of rebellion or rejection of Christ. But it says that Satan will gather them together for war. So he is going to deceive once again through sin and manipulation and by what was already in the heart. It will come to surface and these people will wage war one more time against Jesus. It says, and they came up on the broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city, and fire came down from heaven and devoured them. So fire rains down from heaven. Jesus wins the battle again. And then the Bible says that the devil, it says that great dragon, somebody say that great dragon. In Revelations, it says that serpent of old, that great dragon who deceived many nations. I thought it was interesting because in Revelations, it calls the devil the great dragon. But they said that this great dragon, just imagine, bigger than this building, bigger than a skyscraper, he is the serpent of old. He started off as a serpent, but then he ended up being a great dragon. And we say, well, how did he go from being a little snake to being a dragon? Because he feeds on deception.
That's right.
He feeds on deception and turning hearts from God. So in the very beginning, he just deceived one man and one woman.
That's right.
But then the Bible says by the end, the great dragon has deceived many nations. So how did he go from being a serpent to a dragon? He went from a serpent to a dragon because we fed him.
Yes.
So the Bible says this. It says the devil will receive an eternal sentence in Revelations 20 and 10. And it says that he will be joining the Antichrist and the false prophet in the lake of fire. Now, the deal is there was an angel who came down with a chain and he bound him and threw him into the abyss and outer darkness. This was a different place. But now he's going to be joined with the false prophet and the Antichrist, according to Revelations 20 and 10, in eternal judgment. You see how the Antichrist and the false prophet are still alive. Because it's eternal torment. This is 1,000 years later, and he's now joining them in the lake of fire. What will end up happening, and I'm finished. The believers, I've said this a few weeks ago, we were at the Bema Seat judgment, the judgment seat of Christ. Once we were changed and transformed into our new bodies, we all had to face judgment. But this isn't for heaven and hell. This is for your works. This is for your rewards. If you got up there, then you're good. Somebody say, you're good.
You're good.
If you got up there at that point, you're good. But then there's a great white throne judgment.
Yes.
Where we will partake in that judgment.
That's right.
We will even judge angels.
That's right.
So when we look at it now, like we pray, God, send your angels. God, you get your angels, watch over us. But angels have free will too. The angels rebelled in the beginning. We will now judge angels, which means our ranking is higher than angels even now. Okay? So there's a great white throne judgment. All the people that rebelled against God, all the sinners, they will be judged. The believers will be there, and they will be delivered up into the lake of fire. Once they're delivered up into the lake of fire, everything is wrapped up. Somebody say, everything is wrapped up. There's a new heaven. There's a new earth. We enter into a new Jerusalem. And the Bible says in Revelations 21, 1 through 4, that God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Somebody say every tear. No more sadness, no more weeping, no more death, no more separation, no more sickness, no more disease, no more mourning, no more loss, no more lack, but we will reign with Christ in eternity forever and ever. Somebody say, I'm gonna reign with Christ. Come on, I'm gonna reign with Christ.
We will reign with Christ forever and ever, and there will be no more lack. There will be no more pain. There will be no more war. There will be no more suffering, because it will be completely finished for all eternity. For all eternity. Anybody excited about your future? Everybody standing up on your feet. As we bring it to a close, I just want to suggest four things that we can do in response to the 1,000-year kingdom of the Son of God. Four things we can do. Number one, we can model the kingdom right now where we are. That is the kingdom age of the millennial kingdom. But because we have received Christ, we are to model that every day, where our lives are ran under a theocracy. Jesus is the Lord of our life. And making Jesus the Lord of your life means that you forfeit the right to call the shots in your life. Whatever he says do, you do it. You hearken diligently to him and you obey his voice because we love him. Model the kingdom now. Somebody say, model the kingdom now. That's what he wants us to do. He wants us to set up replicas of Christ's kingdom on the earth. Somebody asks, well, what is the mission and the vision of Willow? It is that we walk in the fullness and the wholeness of the kingdom.
Yeah.
That's it. Is that we walk in the fullness and the wholeness of the kingdom. Number two, we also need to prepare for the kingdom. Somebody say, prepare for the kingdom. Again, what you do now will determine where you're positioned later. And I know that we're all just happy if we make it, right? But it does matter. Number one, your judgment and how you live in that 1,000-year reign. So be aware of that as you're living your life. Constantly shave off and trim the fat.
Yes.
Things that are not like God, remove them. Do things out of love. Do things without selfish motives.
Yes.
Do things when you're not seen, knowing that God sees you and your reward is in heaven.
Right.
Number three, we can honor the King of the kingdom. Live in such a way that brings honor and glory to Jesus by our day-to-day living. And fourth, we prioritize the kingdom. When Jesus says in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else will be added. Hallelujah. Honoring the King, we just want to take a moment and we want to partake in communion. If you don't have it, just raise your hand and we'll get you a cup and some bread. Yes, God.
Thank you,
Lord. Lord, we love you.
Oh, we love you.
Every time we partake in communion, we honor the King. We honor the King, and we are acknowledging his death, burial, and resurrection, and that he lives in our hearts. And so first thing, before we take anything, we just want to take a moment and self-reflect and repent of any sin, unconfessed sin, anything that we've done consciously or unconsciously. We want to reverently honor the Lord as we remember his sacrifice. Thank you, Lord. And Father, we just thank you for your body that was broken for us, for your blood that was shed for us. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. And we thank you, God, every single day we keep your sacrifice afresh in our hearts and we remember what you've done for us today and every day. And so, Father, we thank you. Jesus, we love you. We take your body, which is the bread, and we drink of this cup in remembrance of you. Let's eat the bread and drink the wine. Thank you, Lord.
Somebody should just give God some praise right there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Our altar workers are coming. Our altar workers are coming. I'm going to ask every head bow, every eye close. Every head bow, every eye close. I will never dismiss a service without offering an extension. Many of you have already been touched by the presence of God, and God is delivering you and healing you and setting you free. But maybe there's some in this room right now, God's been working on your heart, and you're saying, listen, I want to be ready for Jesus when he comes. I haven't accepted him as my Lord and Savior. If I died right now, I don't know that I would make it to heaven. If the rapture happened at 1 p.m., I don't know that I would go. That's not a good place to be in. And so I wouldn't leave here unless I got that fix. If you're in here right now and you want to give Jesus your heart and make him your Lord and Savior, every head is bowed, every eye is closed, nobody's looking but me, nobody's judging you. But if that's you and you say, I want to make Jesus my Savior, let me see your hand. Let me just see your hand. Hallelujah. I want to give Jesus my heart. I want to make him my Lord and Savior. All across the room. If you're in here right now and you're saying, okay, Jesus is my Lord and Savior, but I haven't been living a life that he's pleased with. I want to rededicate my heart to him, and I want to recovenant, live a life that he's pleased with. I want to be like those five wise virgins. I want my lamp filled with oil, and I want my wick trimmed. I want to rededicate my heart to Jesus. If that's you and you're in here today, let me just see that hand. I see that hand, my sister. I see that hand, my sister. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand, my brother. I see that hand, my sister. God bless you. God bless you. Listen, this is what I'm going to do. I see that hand, my sister. I'm going to say a prayer. I'm going to say a bold prayer. And if you lifted your hand to rededicate your heart to Jesus, this is where you have to put some feet to your faith. I want you to grab your things. I want you to come down the aisle. We're not going to judge you. We are only going to celebrate you, because heaven is rejoicing and we're going to rejoice with heaven. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you right now for every hand that went up. I thank you for those, God, that are a defining moment, that are rededicating their hearts back to you. Father, give them the strength to step out of the aisle. And we thank you right now that, Holy Spirit, you meet them, and that today is the dawning of a new day. We break fear right now in the name of Jesus. And we release faith by the blood of the Lamb. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. They're coming. Somebody celebrate. They're coming. They're coming. They're coming. Come on, they're still coming. You can celebrate. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They're coming. They're coming. They're coming. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, they're still coming. They're still coming. And if you're in here right now and say you wanted to come, but you just couldn't bring yourself to come, listen, even once we dismiss, the altars are still going to be open. Our altar workers are going to pray with you. God is moving on their hearts, their tears, and God is going to meet you right at the place that you are. Some people say, why do we have to come down? I can confess it in my heart. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. But I'm telling you, confession is good for the soul. It is something about confessing your faults one to another that brings healing, according to the book of James. And so I'm going to pray every single last person up here we have so much respect for, that they can hear God in a crowd like this and obey and step down. And so, Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you so much, Lord. We love you. We praise you. We give you glory and honor. Father, we thank you for your word that's a lamp to our feet. It's a light to our path. And Father, I pray right now, God, that you would just continue to give us insight and revelation, God, on these end times. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your peace and for your favor. As we leave this place but not your presence, bring us back at your appointed time. We'll be careful to give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. God bless you.
Online family, what a great day in the house of the Lord. This millennial reign message today, don't forget to share it online. YouTube, Facebook, wherever you can. There was a lot of information in that. One thing that I was going to say, what a great deliverance this morning. I feel like I've been in church. So this morning was awesome. It was great, the movement and the spirit and all that. So just remember what the pastor talked about. He's talking about going to the next level of faith, right? And he was talking about how you when he was talking about Jackson and those things like that. Just remember, if your expectation is a big deal, fast and pray. It'll help build that faith. Go to the next step. Don't forget to armor up. Don't forget your time, talent, treasure, how we honor our Lord. And be the light that people see. Be the Bible that people want to get to know through you. So until next week, by the way, one other thing. Be sure and email us at onlinecampus@willowchurch.com for that t-shirt. And may the Lord bless you and keep you, give you peace and joy the whole week. And we'll see you next week. Bye, y'all.